Hey guys, so while I was in Tennessee for over 2 months, the past 2 months, my parents and I, we took quite long like road trips or vacation trips, and they were great for the overall part, for the most part. We went from where we were in Tennessee to Florida and visited a couple places. And the second time, I don't know why, but my mom wanted to do another trip. And then we went to Louisiana or New Orleans for the first time. And those were good trips, but you know, America is I consider it, quite a big country. And each state feels sometimes like a totally different country because there's so many differences. Although there are a lot of similarities. And in the future, I will be uploading, I will be making at least because they're not made yet. I need to be making and uploading the videos of those trips. We took a lot of pictures, some video footage actually, so I'll do some editing, which is something I rarely do. I just hit record and just talk, even my Bible reading videos. So yeah, so that will take some time. But I'll definitely talk about the trips in the future. What I want to get at is, you know, these drives are really long, you know, from Tennessee to Florida. For us, it was like 9 hours, or actually it was like a 12-hour drive, considering the entire time. And then from Tennessee to Louisiana was like an 8-hour drive. I mean, considering that we take a lot of breaks during these drives, we don't just go driving, you know, there are some places that we stopped by, but, you know, it was leisurely driving, but my dad drives pretty fast. So, considering, you know, 9 hours or so, a lot of that time is, as you would expect, silent with music, car music in the background, or in our case, with a sermon in the background, or Christian praise music in the background, what have you. But also a lot of time, we talk a lot. There's so much talking in these road trips. And in my case, in my family case, a lot of bickering too. Considering the marriage of my parents is an interesting one to me. I've always kind of felt odded out by it. But they've had some rough patches, and it always kind of really shows during these kind of like vacation trips. Because you're in a car. You're kind of trapped inside a car with the people, you know, with these people only for like the entire duration of this whole trip, which is about a week long. So yeah, it makes sense that sometimes at some point we get sick and tired of each other and we get bickering and what have you. But there's been some incidents, which I won't talk about, but that have kind of made my parents' marriage at this point really, really rocky. And it was very evident here. There were a lot of bickerings. And at certain times when I was in Tennessee, I kind of felt like I was and this is a weird thing to feel, like I was a live-in marriage therapist or something like that. Totally awkward feeling. And sometimes, this is a horrible feeling to have as a son. And I'll be honest about it. But like, sometimes, like, you know how when the marriage therapist, what they want is for the happiness of the individuals, and they're not necessarily, and at least in my opinion, not necessarily for the preservation of the marriage. If it means preserving the marriage, means, you know, they'll be trapped in the marriage, they'll continue to make them unhappy. At certain points, I was just like, man, my parents should get a divorce. That was like what I was feeling like. That was it's a weird thing to be feeling. Like, objectively speaking, I think I can feel that for like any other parents or any other family. But like, for me to feel that to my own parents was a really awkward feeling. But it's the truth. Anyway, they didn't divorce. They're still together. That's besides the point. The point here, the title of this video, is during one. I don't remember which trip it was. Whether it was a Florida trip or the Louisiana trip. Dad and I got to talking, and, you know, my dad and I have completely opposite views on a lot of different things, especially religion and science. So, somehow, I don't know what led to this, but I think we were talking about, like, politics and economies of different countries around the world and something to that effect. Somehow, my dad got to talking about, like, what I consider, like, his apocalyptic conspiracy theory, because it like, terrifies me that he has this view, but, like, the way he says it is quite eloquent, so I'm not going to be able to deliver his eloquence to this, but I don't know, the theory itself is quite crazy, but I feel like this theory would be actually shared by a lot of different Christian ministers, which in itself is terrifying. So, here's what my dad says, and we were talking about, like, you know, different nations and politics and whatever, and economies, and he made the point, like, well, is there a country in the world where they don't have a debt to another country? So, you know, the United States has a debt to China of this amount. China, of course, has a debt to the United States by this amount. All these countries have debts and loans to each other. They borrow money from other countries, and they lend money to other countries. So they all have debts. Not sure how true this premise is, but this is my dad's starting point. So he asked, what country is there in the world that doesn't have a debt? And I was just like, off the top of my head, I haven't done the research. Well, the obvious answer seems to be none, right? There probably isn't. Most likely, I'm not sure, there might be, but I'm not sure of a country that doesn't have a national debt. So I believe all countries do. That's my belief, and that's my dad's belief, so we agree on this premise. And then his second point is, well, there is a governing body, not a country, that doesn't have a debt. So I have no idea how true he's on this. So keep in mind, my dad is a Protestant Christian. His denomination is Assemblies of God, or the nickname of the denomination is Full Gospel. Not a lot of people have heard of this, which surprises me, but this is actually the second biggest Christian denomination in America. I don't know about any other country, but in America, it's the second biggest. And in South Korea, the one church in Yeouido, I think that's the region. The Yeouido Church is the biggest church in the world, and that denomination is Assemblies of God. Anyway, keep that in mind. What he says next is this. Well, the Roman Catholic Church does not have any debt. They lend money to other countries, other churches, to other governing bodies. They're like a country without an actual physical whatever. They do have, like, the papal headquarters in Italy, but in Rome. But his point is they don't borrow money from other governing bodies. Now, I don't know how true this is. I actually don't know if I agree with this premise or if I don't agree with this premise. And then from here on, this is why he says that the Antichrist will come from the Catholic Church. Because the Catholic Church has all this money, all this source. Everyone, every country, every governing body is indebted to each other. There is no country in the world that does not have debt. No governing body, no governing entity that doesn't have any debt. I'm pronouncing this wrong. But they borrow money, and they lend money, but they also borrow money, where the Catholic Church, and I don't know how true this premise is, the Catholic Church does not lend money, but only does not borrow money, but only lends money, something like that. That's why eventually this will be the church. This will be the governing power that that has all this money and all this resources to do what? To control people. To create this microchip that has the number 666 somewhere in there that will go into people, and they can use it as a credit card, or they can scan it. And somehow, all the information, all the resources of the world are going to be funneled into this one source, and that's the Vatican. And from there on, will come this charismatic leader that will rule the world as the Antichrist. He's serious, though. He's serious. He actually believes this. Because, you know, I mean, that, well, he doesn't believe in the exact details of this, but he believes that this might be what is mentioned by the Bible in the, in, you know, in the book of Revelation about the apocalypse and, you know, and the whole believers being, non-believers being left behind, and Satan ruling the world for over 1,000 years, and Jesus coming back and reeling back. Like, my dad is a literal interpretist of the Bible. He is a young earth creationist, and he believes in this kind of apocalyptic conspiracy theory, which, you know, to a certain degree, he has some valid points here. I mean, I'm not sure if the Vatican doesn't have any depth. And I think that's a really poignant point to make. It's something that I've never even considered before. But at the same time, to go from that premise to the conclusion that an Antichrist will come out. And so I was just like, wait, so are you saying that a future pope might be the Antichrist? And my dad was like, it's possible, but it might not necessarily be the pope. But somebody who controls the Vatican will eventually control the world, as is recorded in the Bible, as is prophesied in the Bible. And I didn't really make any objections. I mean, what objections can I make to this conspiracy theory? And I consider it a conspiracy theory. And theory, in this sense, is that word is butchered, because theory in the scientific world has much more weight. So I guess conspiracy, I don't know, hypothesis? Conspiracy musings? Daydreams? I don't know. But, wow, that's all I can really say. It's just, I just wanted to share this. That my dad has this view. It's really interesting. I wouldn't say it's... I try not to have any, like, value judgment. I try not to look down on it and be condescending towards it, because I do feel like a lot of, like, Christians who take their Bible super literally, like my dad, and my mom to a certain extent, but my mom doesn't know the Bible as well as my dad does. My mom tends to stick with one book in the Bible, and that's Proverbs. She reads one chapter of Proverbs a day, because Proverbs has 31 chapters. So today is September 3rd, so she would read Proverbs chapter 3 today. And that's what my mom does. Proverbs is her favorite book in the Bible. But in terms of, like, theological knowledge, my dad probably, you know, he's a pastor and all. He went to, you know, pastor school. Yeah. That's all I can really say is just, yeah, wow. I mean, if any of you guys are watching this and have heard of this kind of conspiracy, daydreams, or musings, or hypotheses, or if this is like the first time hearing about it, like, what do you guys think about this? Is this something that could, I don't know, what do you think? That's crazy. I mean, honestly, knowing me, I'm an atheist. I'm a skeptic. So obviously this seems like a total fairy tale that will never happen in my opinion. But it's just kind of interesting that this somebody could try to derive this kind of conclusion, based on, you know, their worldview and based on this 2,000-year-old text that prophesies that the world will be like that. That some crazy guy called the Antichrist will rule the world for how long, and then there will be Satan who comes afterwards, rules the world for over 1,000 years, only after which Jesus will come down for second coming, and there will be Armageddon, and there will be victory. And angels will sing, and every human being will go back to the original place, which is with God. That is Christianity. That is Christianity, right? And there's people like my dad who actually believe it to be literally true. So... cheers.